In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. We will study tonight chapter 3 from the letter of St. Paul to Romans. Actually, the theme of this letter is about justification, how we are justified. And St. Paul wanted to prove that everybody needs justification and salvation, whether the Jews or the Gentiles. That's why in chapter 1 he spoke about the need of the Gentile for salvation and justification. And in chapter 2, St. Paul spoke about the need of the Jews also for justification. In this chapter, St. Paul will start answering some questions. If both Jews and Gentiles need justification, then what is the advantage of the Jews? And what is the profit of the circumcision, of the law? Why God gave us the law? And why God chose the Jews to be his chosen people? If everybody actually needs justification, then what is the advantage of the Jews and what is the profit of the law or of circumcision? And St. Paul say, yes, they have advantage, but this advantage and this profit doesn't mean that they do not need salvation. It doesn't mean this. And he proved from the scripture, from the Old Testament, that they need also salvation. Then he will discuss what is God's plan for salvation. After he answers the question, what's the advantage of the Jews and what is the profit of the law, he will say, yes, there is advantage and there is profit, but this doesn't mean they don't need salvation. Everybody needs salvation. After this, he will explain the plan of God for our salvation. What God's plan for our salvation? And he will prove to us that this plan fulfilled God's mercy and God's justice. So, as we say, the justice and the mercy of God actually have kissed together in the cross. They have met together in the cross, the justice and the mercy of God. Also, this plan met the requirement of the law. The plan of God's salvation met the requirement of the law. So let's start from reading from verse 1 and try to understand verse by verse. Verse 1, chapter 3. What advantage then has a Jew, or what is the profit of circumcision? St. Paul, after he proved to them that the law cannot save them, the law of Moses cannot save them, exactly like the natural law, which is our conscience, cannot save the Gentiles, then maybe a Jewish person will argue, then what is the advantage of the Jew and what is the profit of the law? Because it is God who gave us the law and who chose the Jewish people to be his chosen people. St. Paul affirms that there are many advantages for the Jews, and also there are many profits for the law. As he said in verse 2, much in every way. There are many advantages for the law and many profits for the circumcision. And when we read much in every way, we understand that yes, there are many, many advantages and many profits, except one thing, which is the ability to save us. the law is unable to save us. But he highlighted one major advantage for the Jews. What it is? Verse 2, much in every way. Chiefly, that's the main advantage. Chiefly, because to them were committed the oracles of God. God entrusted the Jews with his word. They were committed the oracle of God. And when you think about this advantage is a major and a huge advantage. Because God entrusted only the Jewish people with his oracle, with his word. In his word, we read what? We read the plans of God, the plan of God for salvation. So, God's plan for salvation is written in the law, which God entrusted them with it. St. Paul is trying to tell them, although the law cannot save them, but the plan of salvation is written in the law very well, they will know that God had a plan to save them, which is different than the law. It is a plan of grace. It is the incarnation of the Son of God. Also, in the law, or in the oracles of God, written the promises of God, and written also the warning. So, if the natural law, if our conscience start to get weaker and to lose its sensitivity either to sin or to the word of God, we have now the oracles of God to guide us, to tell us this is right and this is wrong. And also we have the warning that make us cautious about the consequences of our sins, and the promises that motivate us and gives us the hope that we need in order to live a spiritual life. So St. Paul is saying, although the law cannot save us, but it has many profits in our life because it has a plan of salvation, it has the promises of God, it has his warnings, it's like a light to our feet, guide us in our way. Verse 3. But what if some did not believe? Will their unbelief make the faithfulness of God without effect? Now St. Paul will answer other questions. The first question he answered, what is the advantage of the Jew and what is the profit of the law? The second question that he will answer, now if the Jews were unfaithful, do you think God will be unfaithful? So is faithfulness of God conditional or unconditional? Conditional means it is based on our faithfulness. Unconditional means regardless we are faithful or not, God will be faithful. So that's the question. What if some did not believe? Will their unbelief make the faithfulness of God without effect? If I don't believe the promises in the law, if I don't believe the plan of salvation that's in the law, do you think God will be faithful or unfaithful? St. Paul answers this question in verse 4 by saying, certainly not. Indeed, let God be true, but every man a liar. Certainly not. Indeed, let God be true, and every man a liar. So St. Paul is saying, although some of the Jews became unfaithful and did not believe, but God fulfilled his plan as it is written in the law. God is faithful. His faithfulness is unconditional. His faithfulness toward us is unconditional. And St. Paul, to prove his point, he quotes a verse from Psalm 50 or Psalm 51. 50 according to Septuagint, 51 according to the Hebrew text. He said, as it is written, that you may be justified in your words, that you may be justified in your words, and may overcome when you are judged. What does it mean? If any person dares to judge God and to tell him, you promised us, but you did not fulfill the promise. So if any person dares to judge God, God will be found just in his saying that you may be justified in your words. Means God will be just, will be righteous in his saying. He fulfilled what he promised and may overcome when you are judged. God will overcome if anybody dares to judge him. And let me remind you the story. Abraham, at one time, with his love to God, he tried to intercede for Sodom and Gomorrah and said to the Lord, the judge of the whole earth, shouldn't be he just? What if in Sodom and Gomorrah 50 persons who are righteous? Are you going to destroy the whole city? So here, like Abraham tried to correct God, to tell him, you are unjust in your judging. You are going to destroy the whole city. Maybe there are 50 persons. And God said to Abraham, go count them. If there are 50 persons, I will not destroy the city. And so on. And at the end, God was found just in his saying. And Abraham was faulty. Because God did not find even 10 persons in Sodom and Gomorrah. All he found were 3 persons, Lot and his 2 daughters. So Abraham tried to judge God, but God actually overcame when Abraham judged him. And when he told him, أَدَيَّانَ الْأَرْضِ كُلَّهَ لَا يَصْلَ عَدْلًا, the judge of the whole earth, shouldn't be he just in his judgment? And God was found just in his words. And also he overcame when Abraham tried to judge him. Then St. Paul answered the third question. So the first question was, what is the advantage of the Jew and what is the profit of the law? Second question, what if some people became unfaithful? Does this make the faithfulness of God without effect? The third question in verse 5. But if our unrighteousness demonstrates the righteousness of God, what shall we say? Is God unjust who inflicts wrath? I speak as a man. St. Paul said, maybe somebody will argue. Now, my unrighteousness demonstrated the righteousness of God. How? By contrast. What do I mean by contrast? When you compare, for example, if I have a piece of cloth, I don't know if it's clean or not. But when I compare it with another piece of cloth, then actually it will be clear whether this is clean or not. So the contrast actually gives best or better picture. So the argument here, when we are unrighteous, this demonstrated the righteousness of God. When everyone is a liar, then the faithfulness of God is demonstrated. When we are unrighteous and full of evil deeds, then the holiness of God is demonstrated. So in a way, we proved that God is righteous and proved that God is faithful with our unrighteousness, with our unfaithfulness. So a human being may argue. That's why he said, I speak as a man. Because usually the human being want to make an argument and to find excuses. So what is the argument here? My unrighteousness demonstrates the righteousness of God. So why God punish me for my unrighteousness? I think that's unfair. Because my unrighteousness actually demonstrated his righteousness. So, is God unjust who inflicts wrath? Is God unjust because he's angry at my unrighteousness or not? So some people may say, but it is my unrighteousness that demonstrated God's righteousness as contrast. So it is fair that God, is it fair that God inflicts wrath on me? St. Paul actually didn't argue about this question. Because everybody knows it is God's right, it's God's right to judge us. For example, a failing student cannot say, you know, my failing demonstrated, you know, the intelligence of my colleagues, so let me pass or move me to the higher grade. You cannot use this argument. That's why St. Paul replied to this in verse 6 by saying, certainly not, for then how will God judge the world? Certainly not, for then how will God judge the world? So St. Paul is saying, far from us be such a thought, for that would strike down all future judgment. If we entertain the thought, then there will be no judgment. God will not judge anybody, and the righteous will be equal to the wicked. That's why we should not entertain the thought at all. He said, certainly not. And then, the last question, the fourth question in this argument, verse 7, he said, for if the truth of God has increased through my lie to his glory, because I am a liar, then the truth of God increased, and this glorified God more. So my sins and my lies contributed to God's glory. Why am I also still judged as a sinner? Why God judge me as a sinner? Was my lie and was my sin, actually, I contributed more to God's glory. So God should not judge me as a sinner. That's the argument here. But St. Paul affirmed that, no, this argument is very, very weak, because God will judge us for our sins. God will judge us for our sins. And I cannot use this argument that my sins showed or demonstrated or contributed to God's glory. And actually, St. Paul used this argument to defend himself against false accusation. Some people accused St. Paul falsely that when he attacked the law and he spoke about how we are saved by the grace of God, so he is saying to the people, now you can do evil because God will forgive us all. And actually, when we do evil, good will come upon us. That's why St. Paul said in verse 8, and why not say, let us do evil that good may come, as we are slanderously reported, and as some affirm that we say, their condemnation is just. So some people actually were falsely accusing St. Paul that he is teaching that let us do evil that good may come upon us. Let us do evil that we glorify God by showing he is faithful, by showing he is true. And St. Paul said, no, this is slander. Some people are slanderously reporting, falsely accusing us. And he said, these people, their condemnation is just because they are not saying the truth. God will condemn them and will judge sin. So since St. Paul was preaching that the works of the law cannot save us, so some people twisted his preaching and made it sound like, let us do evil that good may come, because we are saved anyway by the grace of God. But St. Paul affirms that those slanderers will be condemned justly. Salvation by the grace of God does not mean ignoring good works. Salvation by the grace of God does not mean ignoring good works and leads us to evil, because we will not be saved without good works. Yes, we are not saved by works, but we will not be saved without good works. That's why St. Paul, in many areas in his letters, he mentioned that God will judge the works according to our deeds, according to our words. So, in this passage, in the first 8 verses, St. Paul actually answered 4 questions. The first question, what is the profit of the law and what is the advantage of the Jew? The second question, he answered, if some did not believe, will their unbelief make the faithfulness of God without effect? The third question that he answered, if our unrighteousness demonstrates the righteousness of God, then is God unjust who inflicts wrath on us? And the last question, if the truth of God has increased through my lie to his glory, why am I also be judged as a sinner? Then from verse 9 to verse 20, St. Paul is affirming that even the scripture of the Old Testament, which the Jews believe, because the Old Testament is the Holy Bible of the Jews. So even their own scripture affirms and testifies that the Jews need salvation. That the works of the law cannot save them. Because if the work of the law can save them, then why the law is saying they need salvation? In verse 9 he said, what then? Are we better than they? Are we, the Jews, better than they, than the Gentiles? So, yes, I told you, you have advantage as a Jew, because you were entrusted with the oracles of God. But does this mean you are better than the Gentiles? St. Paul said, no, not at all. Yes, we are all equal before God. Maybe God gave advantage to the Jews by giving them their oracle, his oracles. Why? Because we are the only nation who believed in him before Christ. The only nation that believed in God of heaven and earth were Jews. That's why they were worthy to receive the oracles of God. But this doesn't mean they are better than the Gentiles. Because if we say they are better than the Gentiles, then God will save the Jews only and will not save the Gentiles. But God, everybody is the same for him. All of us who are her children, his children. So he said, are we better than they? Not at all. For we have previously charged both Jews and Greeks that they are all under sin. He said, we are not better. Because as the Gentiles were under sin, also the Jews under sin. Everybody is under sin. Yes, we have the law, but the law couldn't save us. The law couldn't make us better than the Gentiles. So everybody needs salvation. And he proved to them from the scripture that they needed salvation. He said, as it is written, as it is written. And he quoted many verses from Ecclesiastes, from Psalms, from Isaiah, from many chapters in the Old Testament. Any Bible that has cross-references, you can find, you know, the cross-references for these verses. Verse 10, as it's written, there is none righteous, no, not one. So the law here is saying, nobody is righteous, even the Jews. When the Bible said, not one, this includes the Jews. So there was nobody righteous, even the Jews. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks after God. So, St. Paul here is telling us from the scripture, what is the reason of unrighteousness? The reason of unrighteousness is lacking of seeking God, because we do not seek God. And why we do not seek God? Because lack of understanding. He said, nobody understands, nobody seeks after God. So we can say, lack of understanding leads to lack of searching God or seeking God, leads to unrighteousness. But what does it mean, lack of understanding? Lack of understanding the consequences of sin. Lack of understanding the punishment of the sinners. Lack of understanding the judgment day. Lack of understanding the life after death. Lack of understanding about the glory of the righteous in heaven. Lack of understanding of the vanity of the world. Lack of understanding that our world here is temporary and the real life is the eternal life. So lack of understanding makes the person stop seeking God. And because the person will stop seeking God, then he will live unrighteous life. That's why, what is the first step in repentance? If the first step in unrighteousness is lack of understanding, then the first step in repentance starts here, the renewal of mind. As St. Paul said in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, be transformed by the renewal of mind. When our minds are renewed, when our minds are renewed, which means we acquire the mind of Christ and we start to understand, this understanding will lead us to seek God. And when we seek God, we be righteous. There is none who understands, there is none who seeks after God. Verse 12. They have all turned aside. They have together become unprofitable. There is none who does good, no, not one. When we live unrighteous life, we are turned aside, we are turning away from God. Living unrighteous life, stop seeking God, this means we are turning aside, we are drifting from the way. And when we drift from the way, we become corrupted and we become unprofitable. There is no profit in us, there is no fruit in us. In Arabic, actually, it is not unprofitable. In Arabic, fasadu, and they become corrupted. They're like, jami'a zabu wa fasadu. Zabu, if you fasad, they become corrupted. There is none who does good, no, not well. And the person actually will stop doing good, because goodness is the fruit of the Holy Spirit. So when you turn aside, and when the person becomes unprofitable, become corrupted, then there is no goodness in him, so he will not do good. And here just I want to emphasize the word not one. Not one means everybody needed salvation. Then from verse 13, St. Paul will describe in detail their corruption. And all these verses, actually until verse 18, are quotes from the Old Testament. So from verse 10 to verse 18, these 9 verses, St. Paul are quoting these verses from Book of Psalms, as I told you, Ecclesiastes, Isaiah. So all these verses are from the Old Testament. Their throat is an open tomb. Their throat is an open tomb. When the grave is opened, what you will see? You see corruption. That's why when they open their mouth, their throat, what you will hear, just corruption, bad words. That's why he said their throat is like an open tomb. Open tomb, it's open and gives corruption. Utters bad words, ugly words, judgment, lies, cursing, gossip, etc. Their throat is an open tool. With their tongues, they have practiced deceit. They deceive one another with their tongues. With their tongues, they practice deceit. The poison of asps is under their lips. Asp is a kind of serpent that's very, very poisonous. So St. Paul is saying the corruption comes from the throats of men when they speak. They deceive one another. They don't honest or are, they are not faithful with one another. And the venom of asps, the poison of asps, is that's of falsehood. They don't say the truth. It is of falsehood, which is as deadly as the deadly serpent. So this venom of falsehood as deadly as the that of the serpent. Verse 14, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. As I told you, if their throat is like open grave, then when they open their mouth, what do you expect to hear? Cursing and bitterness. Our mouth, as the Lord said to the bride in the Song of Songs, Allah shafataki arusa turat shahda, your lips actually flow with sweet and honey. That's the children of God. Their mouth and their lips should actually utter sweet. But when the person lives unrighteous life and drifted away from God, as St. James said in his letter, chapter 3, verse 6, their tongue will be set on fire of hell. And that's why the tongue will be filled with burning wrath against those whom it should only bless. So instead of blessing others, I will curse others and I will utter bitterness. That's about their mouth and their throat. What about their feet? Verse 15. Their feet are swift to shed blood. And since they are swift to make peace, actually they are swift to cause conflict between people and to shed blood, to kill and murder. Their feet, which should run the way of God's commandments, but now they are employed to the deeds of darkness. They kill and they make conflict about people. And in their way, while they are walking, what you will find? He said, destruction and misery are in their ways. Destruction and misery are in their ways. And the way of peace they have not known. They didn't know the way of peace. Because as I told you, they are not peacemakers. They cause conflict and murder. And they scatter mischief and misery in their paths instead of peace. Because they are stranger to peace. They are not children of God. They don't know peace. And if I'm lacking something, I cannot give it to others. So if I am lacking peace, I cannot give peace to others. So their feet actually will be swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery they will find in their past, and the way of peace they have not known. And he concluded all their sin in one word. There is no fear of God before their eyes. There is no fear of God. When the fear of God is not there, then the person can do anything. When I lack the fear of God in my heart, I will do anything. There is no fear of God before their eyes. So St. Paul, from verse 10 to verse 18, he quoted some verses from the Old Testament to tell them that even you, the Jews, that's how you look like. That's how your law, your book, your holy book, the Old Testament, described you. Which means everyone needs salvation, whether the Gentiles or the Jews. Verse 19. Now, we know that whatever the law says, It says to those who are under the law that every mouth may be stopped and all the world may become guilty before God. So St. Paul is telling them, your law itself will stop your mouth. You who are arrogant, you who are prideful, you think that you are better than the Gentiles. The law is speaking those who are under the law. The law is addressing the Jews. And now, can you argue with your book? Can you argue with the law? So, stop being arrogant, stop being prideful, and say, yes, we are not better than the Gentiles. We are equally need salvation. Those who argue that the law is sufficient, the law itself answers and says, I cannot save you. The law itself says, I cannot save you. That is your condition under the law. That's why you need actually the grace of God in order to be saved. We know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law. So the words of the law are directed to the Jews. That every mouth, the mouth of the prideful and the arrogant, may be stopped. And all the world, whether the Jews or the Gentiles, all the world may become guilty before God. Guilty before God means that everybody needs salvation. Verse 20, therefore, by the deeds of the law, no flesh will be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. St. Paul is explaining to us what is the profit of the law. The law cannot save me, but the law is like a mirror. He showed me how sinful I am. That's why when he said, by the law is the knowledge of sin, I know that I am sinful by the law. How? Let me explain to you. Maybe before the law, I'm stealing, but I don't know stealing is a sin, but I'm stealing. Maybe before the law, I am lying, but I don't know that lying is sin, because my conscience is dead. Now, when I read the law, and the law says, do not steal, when the law said, do not lie, then I knew that stealing and lying are sins. So by the law, I knew my sinful condition. By the law, I understand that I am sinful. But sin, the law did not save me from my sin. Let me give you an example. If this church is not well organized from within and not clean, and it's dark, then you don't know what is the condition of the church from within. When actually you turn on the light and you see the church from within is not organized or is not clean, then actually the light demonstrated to me the condition of the church from within. But do you think the light can clean the church? The light can organize the church from within? No. But it only demonstrated the condition of the church from within. That's exactly what the law did for me. The law told me that I am sinful, and I need a savior, and I need salvation. So it showed me my condition, but it did not save me. Cannot save me. The Lord is unable to save me. I need Christ. The sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross to save me. So that's why he said, therefore, by the deeds of the law, no flesh will be justified in his sight. The law cannot justify me. But by the law is the knowledge of sin. By the law, I understand that I am sinful and I need salvation. Then from verse 21, he starts to speak about God's plan for salvation and his righteousness. God's righteousness and his plan for salvation. He said, but now the righteousness of God apart from the law is revealed, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. First, what does it mean apart from the law? He said the righteousness of God apart from the law is revealed. What does it mean apart from the law? Because we receive the righteousness of God not through the acts of the law or the works of the law, but how we receive the righteousness of God? Through faith, through baptism. And the law did not speak about baptism and did not speak about, you know, believing in the sacrifice of Christ. So when you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and when you are baptized and you participate in the sacraments of the church, you will be justified. That's why the child, when we baptize him, we dress him in white, means that he is justified. Now he is pure through baptism and through believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. And also, the law was only for the Jews, but the righteousness of God is for everybody. So if we say the righteousness of the God is not apart from the law, then the righteousness of God or this salvation will be the plan of salvation only for the Jews. But that's why he said apart from the law. Apart from the law, the righteousness of God is for everybody, for the Jews and for the Gentiles. The righteousness of God apart from the law now is revealed, witnessed by the law and the prophets. As I told you, in the law of Moses and in the book of prophets, the plan of salvation was written. So from the law and from the prophets, we understand the plan of God's righteousness, God's salvation. Although the law cannot save me, but it spoke to me about the plan of salvation. And when he said is revealed, means through the incarnation of Jesus Christ and his crucifixion, the righteousness of God now is revealed. But now the righteousness of God apart from the law is revealed. So apart from the law is revealed when Jesus died on the cross. But this death, this salvation was witnessed, we read about it in the law and the prophets. Verse 22. Even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ to all and on all who believe, for there is no difference. The gate into this righteousness. What is the first step in order to receive this righteousness? Is to believe. That's why he said, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ. You need to believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. You need to believe that Jesus died for my sins. You need to believe that Jesus rose from the dead to justify me. And when you believe, this is the gate into righteousness and justification. Without believing in Jesus Christ, there is no justification. There is no salvation. There is no righteousness. That's why he said, through faith in Jesus Christ. And this righteousness is to all, to everybody, to Jews and to Gentiles. Not only to Jews, but to everybody. And on all who believe, on all, as St. Paul said, at the last, he put on me the crown of righteousness. So this righteousness will be like a crown on our heads. So, to all or for all, for everybody will be righteous. And on all, we will receive as a crown, the crown of righteousness. For there is no difference, no difference before God between the Greek and the Jews, between the Gentiles and the Jews. And everybody sinned. That's why he said in verse 23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It is for all, because all have sinned and all lost the glory of God. With sin we lost the likeness of God. With sin we lost the grace of God. with sin we lost the glory of God. Adam and Eve, the moment they disobeyed God, they lost this glory. And everybody from their offspring also fell short of the glory of God. That's why everybody needs salvation. Verse 24. Now he's explaining the plan of salvation. Being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. The justification is a free gift by the grace of God. Is a free gift by the grace of God. Let me explain to you the difference between the law and the New Testament. The law is telling us, you need to do this and this, you are a sinner. You are a sinner. And you need to do this and this and this and this and this in order to be justified. So, if you didn't keep the whole law, if you break one of the commandments of the law, you are not justified. And nobody was able to keep the law. That's why nobody was justified. But in the New Testament, once you believe in Christ, without doing anything, then after baptism, you are justified. So the New Testament, you are righteous. You are justified. You know, as I told you, when you baptize a child, what did that child do to be justified? Nothing. He didn't do anything to be justified. But we dress him in white robes. Why? To say he's justified, he's righteous. So once I am baptized, then I am justified, I'm righteous. Without doing anything, it's a free gift by the grace of God. And now, I need back to keep this white garment white, not defiled. So I received the white garment, now I have to keep it white. And if it's defiled at any moment, we have the blood of Jesus on the altar to wash it and keep it white. But in the Old Testament, the starting point is, I am a sinner. And I am chasing God to be righteous. And nobody will be able to be righteous. That's why he said, being justified freely, it's a free gift. We didn't do anything. This justification that we received from God is a free gift. We are justified, being justified freely by his grace, by the grace of God. It's a gift from God. Through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. It is free because the price of our sins was paid by the Lord Jesus Christ, who died and redeemed us. Redemption means there is a price. There is a price. That's the word redemption means. In Arabic, لما حد بس حاجة بتتكسر يقول لك فداء. ما الفداء redemption معنى الفداء. فداك يعني ايه؟ يعني دي دفعت البرايس. الحاجة اللي اتكسرت دي خدت البرايس خدت العقوبة بدالي. So, to say something redeemed me means this thing actually paid the price instead of me. That's what redemption means. الفداء. So, now there's a punishment for sin. How we became justified freely? It's through that redemption. Because Jesus Christ paid the price on my behalf and on your behalf. That's why we received it as a free gift. The price and the cost was paid by Jesus. That's why we received it as a free gift. That's why he said, being justified freely by his gift through the redemption, through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Verse 25, whom God sent forth as a propitiation by his blood, through faith, to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance, God has passed over the sins that were previously committed. Let me interpret this verse word by word. He said, whom referring to Jesus. So God sent Jesus forth as a propitiation. God the Father sent forth the Lord Jesus Christ as propitiation. That is propitiation. Propitiation in Arabic means kafara. كفارة. And you have to understand these terms, justification معناها إيه؟ Redemption and propitiation. Justification هو التبرير, redemption هو الفداء. Propitiation, يعني propitiation. كفارة means to cover with blood. To cover, كفارة to cover. So propitiation means he covered us with his blood. Why with blood? Because without shedding blood, there is no forgiveness. Because shedding the blood is a price. So how Jesus redeemed us? By covering us by his blood. He covered us with his blood. That's why we read in the book of Revelation, those who washed their garments in the blood of the Lamb. غَسَّلُوا ثِيَابَهُمْ فِي دَمِ الْخَرُوفِ. So we wash our garment in the blood of the Lamb. We cover ourselves with the blood of the Lamb. And عارفين الملاك يقول لك أرى الدم وأعبر. The angel who killed the firstborn the Egyptian, he said, I will see the blood and pass over. أعبر, pass over. I will see the blood and pass over. So when we are covered by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, we become righteous. That's how we are righteous. So St. Paul, he explained, what does it mean the redemption? Whom God, by sending Jesus Christ as propitiation by his blood. By his blood, to cover us by his blood. Through faith. Through faith means by believing in Jesus Christ. Or what you need to do just to believe in him, to believe in this propitiation, then you will be covered by his blood and you will receive the white garment, and then you need back to keep the white garment. To demonstrate his righteousness. Because his righteousness was not demonstrated before. Yani was not demonstrated before. In the Old Testament, we see many people commit sins, but they were not judged. They did not die. And if God actually killed all of them and destroyed them, then where is his mercy? So in the Old Testament, the righteousness of God was not clear, was not manifested. Because the death, the sin were not punished, or even if the sin was not punished, then where is the mercies of God and where is his promises? When he promised Adam and Eve that the descendant or offspring of the woman will crush the head of the serpent. But at the time of crucifixion, now the plan of God is revealed. And now his righteousness was demonstrated when he covered us by his blood. So when he covered us by his blood, so now the justice of God was revealed, and also his mercy was revealed. Justice, because that's the punishment of sin, we are covered by his blood. And mercy, we are saved from death into eternal life. That's why he said, to demonstrate his righteousness. Because in his forbearance, God, in the Old Testament, he endured. That's the forbearance of God. That's the long suffering of God. He endured and he was patient and long suffering with us. In his forbearance, God has passed over the sins that were previously committed. So all the sins that were previously committed from Adam until his crucifixion, all these sins God forgave to those who believed in him. To those who believed in him in the Old Testament. So, who enjoyed the salvation? Not only the people in the New Testament, but also the people in the Old Testament who believed in the promise of salvation, also they enjoyed this salvation. So, we can say, before Christ, God was not remitting sins, but only forbearing to pass them by. There was no forgiveness in the Old Testament. There was no real forgiveness and no real punishment. But God actually just was forbearing to pass them by until adequate atonement for them should be made. By not punishing the sins immediately, God's righteousness was not manifested. His righteousness was not manifested because he did not punish the sin immediately. But when God set forth Christ as propitiation by his blood for the believers, his righteousness became manifested in passing by the sins of the believers before and in remitting our sins now. Was this point clear? Clear? Okay. So, whom God set forth as propitiation by his blood through faith to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance, in the Old Testament, God forbearing our sins, God has passed over the sins that were previously committed until the time of atonement, adequate atonement comes. Verse 26. To demonstrate at the present time his righteousness, to demonstrate on the cross his righteousness to us, that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. So might be hijab, that he might be just, his justice appeared, and justifier, his mercies, because he's not only just, but he justified me. That's his mercy. So he is not only proved to be just, but also justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus, who believe in Jesus, were justified. So he covered us by his blood, and thus his righteousness was manifesting in punishing death, sins by his death. Also his holiness was manifested by fulfilling his promises. And his mercy was manifested by redeeming us and justifying us and giving us eternal life. His love and his justice also was manifested by redeeming the believer in every time and in every place. So, on his cross, the Lord Jesus Christ demonstrated his love, his mercy, his righteousness, his holiness, his justice. After St. Paul explained the plan of God's salvation from verse 21 to 26, now, in the last four verses, he spoke about what are the implications of God's righteousness. What does this imply? What does this mean? In verse 27, he said, "Where is boasting then? It is excluded. By what law? Of works? No, but by the law of faith." The first implication here, now we cannot boast with our works. I cannot say I did so and so and so and now I am righteous. There is no boasting. Where is boasting then? It's a free gift for everybody. You cannot boast, I cannot boast. The Jews cannot boast, the Gentiles cannot boast. Where is boasting then? It's excluded. And by what law? Excluded by the law of works? By the law of the Old Testament? No. But by the law of faith, believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. And just this reminds me of what St. Paul said. We boast in the cross of Jesus Christ. So we boast in the cross because that is a sign of our salvation. But it's interesting that St. Paul said the law of faith. Law of faith. Many people think that faith is just you believe and that's it. But St. Paul says the law of faith, which means faith has a law. Faith is not theoretical, but practical, has law and has works. So that is the law of faith. If you believe in something, then show me your faith by what? But by your works. Verse 28. Therefore, we conclude, he makes a conclusion, that a man is justified by faith apart from the deeds of the law. So that is the second conclusion. that justification is based on faith, not on the deeds of the law. The law cannot justify me. So the first implication, boasting is excluded. Number two, justification is by faith, not by the works of the law. Number three, verse 29. Or is he the God of the Jews only? God actually saved everybody on the cross. So if he saved everybody, then we conclude that he is not the God of the Jews only. He is God of everybody, of the Gentiles and the Jews. Is he not also God, the God of the Gentiles? Yes, of the Gentiles also. So that is the third implication. God is God of the Jews and Gentiles. For he justifies both Jews and Gentiles by the faith, not by the law which was given only to the Jews. And the last implication, number 4, verse 30. Since there is one God who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith. So God will justify both Jews and Gentiles. Jews are the circumcised. Gentiles are the uncircumcised. And he justified both of them by what? By faith, not by the works of the law. Verse 31, do we then make void the law through faith? Now we said we are justified by the law. So can we conclude that the law has no effect, has no benefit? Should we void the law? Should we make void the law through faith? St. Paul said, certainly not. On the contrary, we establish the law. What does it mean, we establish the law? This doesn't void the law or the need for the law, but rather the plan of God's salvation met the requirement of the law. The plan of justification met the requirement of the law. How? Because the law revealed our sins and our need to be justified. And now here's the plan to justify me. Without the light, I didn't know that the church needs cleaning. So, again, without the law, I cannot recognize that I need justification. So that's why, actually, the plan of God's justification fulfilled the law, proved that the words of the law were correct. When the law told me that I am not just, I'm not righteous, I need to be justified. So the plan of God's salvation actually established the law. Established the law says we need justification. Also the law, as St. Paul said, bore witness for the plan of salvation. So the law guided me to believe in Christ. Guided me. All the people in the Old Testament, those who died on the hope of faith. What hope of faith? The faith that was revealed to them in the law. So actually the law helped them to believe in Jesus Christ, even before his coming. By faith, the goal of the law, which is our justification, is fulfilled. Why God gave us all this requirement in the law? To tell me that if I keep all these requirements, I'll be justified. But nobody was able to keep the requirement of the law. So God gave us the other plan of redemption to justify. So this plan of salvation actually fulfilled the goal of the law, which is our justification. And finally, by believing in God's plan for our salvation, the transgressions against the law of God were forgiven. Every transgression against the law of God was forgiven. So this plan did not make the law void, but actually this plan established the law. Established the law because we are sinners, and that's what the law said. We needed a savior, and the law guided us to this savior. Every transgression against the law was forgiven, and also the goal of the law, which is our justification, was fulfilled. So St. Paul made four implications based on God's plan for our salvation. The first implication, no boasting. Number two, God's plan is for the Jews and the Gentiles. God is for everybody, not only for the Jews. And number three, justification is based on faith, not on the deeds of the law. And finally, that this plan did not make the law void, but actually established the law. Glory be to God forever and ever.